where should one start with, say, policy or legal or things like that? Because, I mean, I can look up, you know, on Justica and start doing legal research, but where would you suggest as an outside, you know, someone who's worked in government, what would you suggest to ordinary people? Where should they start looking to understand, you know, where the bureaucracy has the power it does?
Wow. That's a hard question. So I may sidestep it slightly and we could go back to it. I do think I can answer it indirectly, or at least how I would go about it, because I think that's almost an existential question to talk about how the bureaucracy, it's like a Curtis Yarvin question, exercises power, right? But like at a more nuts and bolts level, and I think this is important, for example, for this thread to talk about media, a first source, not my only source, despite what some people were screaming about on Twitter, everything was multi-sourced in that piece. But a first place I went to get some of the information for this piece was Kiwi Farms, which was a site I was not really familiar with, but I suppose that perhaps a number of your more autistic folks were in this chat.
I love the mental image of you or anyone who's worked in Washington going on Kiwi Farms for research. This is how it's done, people.
Right. Well, here's the thing, right? So there's a bunch of stuff on there. I don't know the whole site. I was only paying attention to, you know, the particular thread that was 8,000 posts that I was interested in. There were a lot of things on that thread that I would not associate myself with, that I would consider mean, trollish, kind of obnoxious, maybe sharing information that I think should not be shared and are, reasonably expected to be private. So, you know, having done all that throat clearing and disclaiming, you know what else was there? Was a ton of great investigative reporting, or what we used to call investigative reporting, that was generally sourced, that pointed to resources that I then later consulted that were outside of Kiwi Farms on totally respectable places and was documented. And it was weird because who was being done it? It was all these autistic internet people who were doing it for free. And the difference was there were actual facts. You know, it wasn't just, I don't like transgenderism, but like, look at all the crazy deviant stuff this guy has done. And oh, by the way, here's, you know, his divorce records. And I didn't put all that in there because, again, my goal was not to do a character attack on any of these people. It was simply to show that these people were not really who they were representing them to be. And they had a number of kind of interests and backgrounds that would be considered well outside the mainstream. I think that also applies to our media. Fox is taking a lot of hits right now, and I think totally justifiably for kind of their disgraceful proxy war against Tucker. I had a tweet just before I came on that said a lot of that is because they're in New York City, and you're just never going to really have, in my opinion, a durably conservative organization, media organization based out of New York City. So you have to look at a Nashville or a Dallas or somewhere like that. And in places like that, even though, yes, I know, as a couple of my commentators pointed out, the cities themselves are not necessarily that conservative. But if you look, say, at Nashville, every single county around the city of Nashville is somewhere between solidly red and deep red. And the state is red. And so you can attract red-minded people who might work in the city, but they live in their nice Republican suburb, and you can sustain a conservative organization. So I'd say that's the media piece. And on the policy piece, again, I think it's so idiosyncratic. You've just got to call up a legislator. And in many cases at the state or local level, it's incredible the amount of power you can get by just having, just caring a little bit.
Yeah, I think that that's a very good point, is that even where I live, right, like a lot of the counties around the Dallas-Fort Worth metroplex are very solidly red, and the exurbs or the suburbs are always a good place to look to, because those people probably do travel to the city to work. I know plenty that do, who are attorneys that work in Dallas. I know a guy that makes a lengthy journey to work for inside as a lawyer at the Zion Natural Gas and Oil Building, right? Like, those things are definitely a good way to look at where you can find quality candidates. And yeah, your tweet about that, a core problem of any conservative organization, you know, is you can't expect it to say conservatives, right? That's like Robert Conquest laws, is that, sure, you know, any right-wing organization or conservative organization will inevitably turn liberal. And I think that geography will be a good way to have a reserve of people that if they notice that things are moving in a leftward direction, someone could be like, okay, we can bring people, you know, say outside of, you know, say like in Denton or something like that, right? Like they could bring people north of Dallas in to help, you know, replenish that conservative reserve. So, I mean, again, like these are all very important points. And maybe this can be a good way to go back towards that more existential question would be, in respects to how we research these things, how we understand law works. You had mentioned a really interesting point earlier, and I kind of want to dig back at it, was that you had said there are some things that Congress doesn't want to lose in terms of power, but the bureaucracy takes it anyway. What are some examples of that? Where is the bureaucracy just this power hungry, ravenous machine that's, you know, stealing power from Congress?
Well, civil rights law is one of the most notorious examples to me of this, and a really important one, in which if you look at it and go back and look at the legislative debates around the Civil Rights Act, they were really clear. I mean, they were obnoxiously overly clear that something like disparate impact should not be allowed to happen. That this was, you know, that quotas weren't in, that this type of reasoning was not going to be acceptable. They couldn't have been much more clear. And yet the bureaucracy over time just kind of did it anyway. And we haven't been smart enough to flip that around. And so it's shocking the amount. You see this with some of the environmental policy acts as well, where there were very clear things that were put in saying, you know, we want to do this with this law, or do not interpret this law to mean this. And then you look 10 years later and the law has been interpreted to mean just that. And even if a conservative organization is smart enough to then challenge that interpretation in court, if they get the wrong judge, then it doesn't go anywhere. And even if they get the right judge, ultimately, maybe there's a long judge, wrong the judge, and the Supreme Court only has so much bandwidth, and so it just doesn't get taken up. It's just not a sustainable way. And so that's why actually changing the content of who is in the bureaucracy is really important.
Yeah, I mean, you see this as well with the Supreme Court. I mean, you know, you look at some of the earliest cases with Griswold v. Connecticut. You know, I think it was Justice Black that had raised the question in his dissent. Or no, it was oral argumentation, if I remember correctly, where he was just like, this, you know, this privacy idea that we're using for contraception, I feel may pave the way for legalizing abortion somewhere down the future. Sure. The justices at the time said, no, of course not. But as we saw, that sort of in this privacy right that had been invented, right? It started with contraception in a domicile, married couples to, you know, writ large abortion in the span of 10 years from 1963 to 1973. So I agree with you wholeheartedly that it really is about personnel. And so, you know, it kind of goes back to that institutional question, because we just talked about a few of them earlier. For people that want to get involved, what would you suggest? Because there is this big conversation now about sort of credentialism, how the university systems how operate. Are we looking for people, or, and by we, I mean these institutions, are they looking for people that are more of what you would expect traditionally of these guys that, you know, did, you know, mock trial in college and have a law degree? Or is there this diversification of people with different backgrounds and so on?
Well, one thing I would say is, if you want to have one way to have an effect is join the government. And I realize that that's like a little painful, especially for some of our more traditional, quote unquote, small government conservatives. But, you know, I think we're intellectually, we are beginning to get out of that cul-de-sac, which is great, and understanding that power is actually good to use. But we now need to instrumentalize that in, we need to be in the bureaucracy. And I'll just, again, give you an example from Interior. We did have a few folks, not a lot, but a few folks in that bureaucracy who were kind of known to be at least somewhat conservative. Some, you know, maybe one or two even very conservative. When we got in, we elevated those guys to senior positions within the bureaucracy because we knew we could trust them to carry out our lawful agenda, which is appropriate. And again, if there are situations, and I have this with a couple friends in the diplomatic corps who I'm encouraging to kind of go build out networks, I would love to have, as a political appointee, a built-in set of 50 guys in the bureaucracy who are kind of waiting their time, who I can come in and say, you know, hey, like, I'm going to help you a lot. I'm going to build your career and do that. But we need to have those people there. So there's no substitute in terms of influencing the government for sometimes just joining the government. And I think for some greater subset of people than we have now, they should grin and bear it and see if they can do that.
Hmm.